I'm DJ Supreme, formerly of Hijack, DJ, producer, from South London originally, Brixton to be precise. That's where I grew up, spent most of my time there. So South London I by heart. Living in Switzerland right now, so I moved out there in 2000. Yeah, started making music again after a long retirement about 2 years ago. So that was like 2014.
I'm Curoc from Sound of Noise, 1990s hip hop group. And I now am currently involved in what's called the Four Pillars hip hop movement. Originally from East London, and then about 1992, I decided to move over to South London, and I've been in South London ever since.
My background with regards to where I grew up had a big influence on my music. Brixton at the time was kind of like, I could describe it now as sort of like a bombed out zone. There was a lot of debris and dereliction there. And I remember playing on building sites. That's how I grew up. So you had that kind of rough kind of backdrop with all this wonderful mixture of different kind of music. And that came together in the way that I kind of make music today. And it's kind of like really experimental, because if I compare a Bob Marley and a David Bowie, they were, for what they did, they were ahead of their times. And that influence, being ahead of their time and doing something that was totally different and artistic and against the grain, against what everything else that was happening at the time, that kind of led to my style musically, I think. It was a big influence.
Yeah, I do think the kind of the way that I deliver my lyrics now has got something to do with the way I grew up, especially coming from like a single parent family. I think I've got a lot of aggression, probably a lot of issues that I like to get off my chest. So I kind of get it all out when I'm doing my thing on the mic. So yeah, definitely, I 100% say growing up has got a lot of influence on what I do right now and did back in the 90s as well.
In the early 80s, there was a lot going on. I mean, I was very much a recluse, a bedroom guy, but I had my ear to the radio, which was always on. And I knew a little bit through the school community that was buzzing with this new thing called hip hop. So there was a lot of people already getting involved, and straight away a lot of names came out of the whole Covent Garden scene. MC Mello, Pogo, Cosmic Jam, DJ J, Streets Ahead, Even Undercover. A lot of people were already coming out. The Syndicate, DJ Fingers. I'm naming a lot of DJs because that's my lane. That was my lane back then. So a lot of people were establishing themselves, and those for me were the inspirations. I would hear them on Westwood Show. I would see their names on flyers. I wouldn't go to the events, but I would see them everywhere. And the funny thing is that a lot of them were from South London. I was really awed by those guys because they were establishing themselves, but it drove me to actually be in that position as well. So I really wanted to be a part of that whole scene, and I really looked up to those individuals that were already making waves, already establishing the scene and becoming sort of like, you know, the key holders and the carrying the torch and establishing themselves as legends so early on in the game. And I wanted to be a part of that.
Back in the day, my influences were groups like the Capital Boys, Junior G, MC Duke, JC001, obviously Wizkid and those kind of crews that were out at the time. Major influences, you know, I mean, going forward from that, from the 80s, it was going on to people like London Posse, Crazy Noddy. I was massively influenced by lots and lots of hip hop crews. I mean, I could sit here all day talking about it, but I won't. But there are so many names, and I apologise if I've forgotten to mention your name, but believe me, there's so many hip hop crews from London that I used to listen to back in the day.
The first people that I basically reached out to when I wanted to do the EP for Legacy Version 2, involving different artists from that era, was Son of Noise, Mello and Huckleberry Finn. And the first person to get back to me was Curoc from Son of Noise, and that was it, basically.
My lyrical mindset was, give me mine, basically. As an MC, it's a very competitive thing to get involved in. And, you know, you go onto social media and you see all these people having these debates of who their favourite MC is and blah, 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 blah. And throughout the years, you get people coming up to you, meeting you in person, going, you're the greatest MC out there. You know, you're one of my favourite. And then you'd go onto social media and look at who these people put down, and your name wasn't mentioned. So my lyrical mindset is, right now, I want my name to be on that list of your favourite MCs.
2 weeks later, I got the beat back and I was like, whoa, this doesn't sound like the guy that I remember. So, and as I said, I'm still very, very competitive. And basically, he just ate up the beat. So for me, it was like, okay, I can't have that. So I took out all the music and then I made a new track to fit with the vocal, that it marries perfectly, that the energy was right. The energy in the first version was right. And actually the Son of Noise guys, they actually liked the first version. But I think that the version that I did after speaks volumes in making sure that the pronunciation, the venom, and the lyrical content of the vocal shone through. So even in that sense, in doing that track with Son of Noise, there was a battle element involved. From my view, I had an MC who was very, very hungry, and musically I didn't deliver it at the right pitch for him, but he still came hungry. And then I thought, okay, I need to step the music up a bit more. And that's where the marriage became perfect. It was a perfect combination. And when I look at that, with the scratching and everything else, it was like everything came together like it was 1989.
So that was my mindset. I'm like, you know what, just give me mine. I just want to see my name mentioned and let people out there know that, you know, we haven't fallen off. When I say we, it's not just Son of Noise, it's Supreme as well. We haven't fallen off. We've still got that energy. And to us, making that kind of music it's like breathing. It's natural. It's not a big thing to us. It's just what we do. It's all we know. So there you go. That was my mindset.
The video came about after a few sessions on Skype with Curoc and Pritt, Kalsi. And we had a discussion about the record and what we should do for it. And we had like a concept. The only thing that I could put out there as a concept was Eric B and Rakim, Juice Know the Ledge. And I just really liked the whole image of that video. And the look and feel of it. And I had this vision of, like, you know, being on a dark street, being in a cul-de-sac, that kind of vision. But that's all I had to offer in terms of in terms of my ideas. We had like a loose kind of concept in our minds, what we were going to do, what we were going to shoot, the locations. But I think it all changed when we were on set and started to actually shoot the video. And I got to give props to Curoc, because basically, he held that whole thing together. I mean, the intensity of the track brought out a certain element in him that basically is captivating in the video. I mean, just looking into his eyes, he just looks like a psychopath. And I think that stems back to how music can actually evoke emotion in people. He's a really nice guy. He's not really like that. But the music just does something to him. And I think it was the perfect combination of the right track, the right energy, the right performance, and the right filming. And based on Curoc's performance, the whole video was basically hung off that. So we hung the whole video off that performance, which was probably the least amount of time that we spent, which is the bridge shots. We spent a least amount of time for the whole day doing that shot, but that became the focal point for the whole video shoot. And basically a testimony to the performance, I think. So at the end of the day, it's like it came out as what it was, as a vision of Pritt. He put it together and he was adamant that this was the way to go. There was a little bit of a fighting going on, but but I took total trust in him, and he definitely made the right decision on the vision, the visuals, the black and white, using black and white, using splashes of color, The edits, everything was done just perfectly. So the combination of the music, the performance, and then the film on top of it, it was like, I mean, the response is like, it's just a testament to the work. So the fact that it's got like nearly 40,000 hits now, so is like amazing for me. It's like, it's a shock, but at the same time, knowing full well the quality of the performances and the performances of the people involved and the work that went into it is, I mean, I think it's justified. Everybody put in the hard work and they should feel rewarded that it's been received so well. The Legacy series still goes on. So I'm still working on new music, obviously the follow-up remix single to R.I.P. Which will drop soon. New works with Son of Noise, Curoc, Killer Instinct, MC Mello, and a few other notables. So yeah, there's a lot of stuff in the pipeline. So hopefully you'll see more from Backbone Records, myself and a lot of other artists by the years out.
The funny thing with Supreme is that, you know, I just said, I'm just gonna do this one track. And then he throws me another beat and I'm like, why the hell am I still writing for this guy? The music speaks to me. Supreme makes music that speaks to me. So there's probably going to be an EP coming out. I hope so. But that's down to Supreme and another chap that I'm working with called Max Cyrus. You know, if we all get this collaboration popping off, then we're going to have a nice little EP.
R.I.P. Insane Macbeth, Keith Rogers.
We've lost Gemini. We've lost another great producer, stroke DJ Mark B. All these guys were big in the hip hop game. You know, I just like to take the time out to say R.I.P. to those guys. We're at that stage now where you just don't know what's going on in life in general. You know, one minute you could be healthy, the next minute you're out. So my thing now is just live life to the fullest. And like I said, I salute these guys. R.I.P. to them all.
That's what I'm talking about.